Now, one very important theorem which is coming up is Chinese remainder theorem. And this one you have to practice a lot. But Chinese remainder theorem is another thing that we use in public key. And all it does is that if you have a large number, you want to do a mod of a large number, if the large number can be factored, then you can do small mods. So if big M is equal to M1, M2, MK, then you can do mods M1, mod M2, mod MK, and then somehow combine them to get mod M. Okay? So you can use little moduli, and so the formula is a little bit complicated. But once you do it two or three times, it becomes very trivial to understand. But right now the formula is written here. A mod M, where M is large number, is equal to, you go with each moduli separately, and each modulus actually, I don't know, moduli. Anyway, so A mod MI, little MI, times the inverse, basically M upon MI, so which is, this means the rest of the M's, because M is a product of M1, M2 to MK. When you put MI in the bottom, this leaves everything else, times M upon MI, the same number inverse mod MI. Now this is fixed number. This doesn't depend upon A. And therefore you can calculate this beforehand, this whole thing beforehand, even this one beforehand. So you can calculate this beforehand, and every time the number A changes, all you do is A mod MI, which means M1, and then A mod M2, A mod M3, A mod MK. And then for each of those numbers, you multiply by this pre-calculated quantity. So let's try to do this. We want to find out what is 452 mod 105. Now obviously, we won't be doing it for this, because by the time we do all this Chinese remainder theorem, we can calculate 452 mod 105. But just imagine that 105 is a big number. Okay? And then this one comes handy. And obviously, for that, 452 has to be a big number too. In fact, if the modulus or moduli is 100 digit, then for anything less than 100 digit, you don't need to do anything. It's only when you have 200 digits, then you need to divide and find out what the value is, right? So these are big numbers, imagine. So anyway, 105 has three factors, 3 times 5 times 7, right? So we can calculate 452 mod 3, we can calculate 452 mod 5, we can calculate 452 mod 7. To each of these three mods, we multiply these two quantities. First quantity is this big M divided by 3, big M divided by 5, and then big M divided by 7. And then the second quantity is the inverse of that mod 3, inverse of that mod 5, inverse of that mod 7. And then we add up all of these. Right? So first let's see, how do you find out this quantity? 1 upon 05 divided by 3 is how much? 35. So we want to find out 35 inverse mod 3. 35 inverse mod 3. So let's say 35 inverse is equal to mod 3 is x. That means 35 inverse is x mod 3. Or if you were to take other way around, 35x is 1 mod 3. So what value of x will give you 1 mod 3? If you put x equal to 1, 35 mod 3 will give you how much? 35 mod 3 is how much? 2. So that is not 1, right? If you put x equal to 2, how much is x? Then it will be 70. 70 mod 3 is 1. So x equal to 2 is the answer. Right? But there is a better way to find this x. Does anybody remember how you find inverse? Nobody remembers how you find an inverse? There was a tabular method we had talked about or something. So the real method to find the inverse is by the tabular method. You would write down, when you want to find out 35 inverse mod 3, you would write down a table with 3 and 35 and do the whole table. It should not take many rows, but within one or two rows you will come to 2 and that you will know that the inverse is 2. Similarly, you need to find out the second here. This one is how much? 21 inverse mod 5. 21 inverse mod 5. And you will need to do that table here and then find out that in that case the inverse is 1. And here we need to find out 15 inverse mod 7. And that will tell you that x is equal to 1. So, we found the inverse, we put the values of those inverses and then we multiply. So, this one is 2 times 35 times 2. This one is 2 times 21 times 1. This is 4 times 15 times 1. You multiply the whole thing, 140 plus 42 plus 60 mod 105, 242 mod 105 is 32. Alright, so really, I mean, we did so much calculation, we could have, for 105, we could have just divided that and gotten 32. However, if 105 was a big number, again, I should say that this one comes very handy. For a small number, it doesn't really help that much. And I'm going to repeat this so that everybody understands. I know there's a lot of mathematics here, but the formula is, the Surchani's Riemannian theorem helps when you have a modulus which is a product of many moduli. Moduli is the plural of modulus. So you can do piece by piece. You can do mod respect to each and then you can multiply with something that you have pre-calculated. So these things are pre-calculated. They don't depend upon A. And the way you pre-calculate is that you divide m by mi and then you divide, multiply by its inverse. So this is interesting. We take whatever number it is, 35 times 35 inverse, right? To find the inverse, you need to use that table method, or you can just do by inspection method. This is what we call inspection method here, is that we want to find out what is the value of x that will give us mod 3. And so basically, same way we can write down, we can bring x on the other side, x and 35. So basically, we bring 35 on this side, so we get 35x equal to 1. So x equal to 1, we try out and it doesn't work. X equal to 2 works, and we get x equal to 2. So this is inspection method. For small moduli, it works, right? But for large, it will not. I mean, for large, you will need to do the table because you will otherwise be trying out every possible value of x. Does it look like something you can do? Now, this will be in the exam for sure. I don't have any exam in which I did not ask about the Chinese Riemannian theorem. You're guaranteed. There will be a problem in the exam where you will be given the numbers and you have to do Chinese Riemannian theorem. Because this tests everything that we need to test. Many things actually, not everything. It tests that you can do the tabular part, that tabular thing, then I don't give you a separate problem for table. And then it tests that, you know, you understood all of this. You do have to do one or two problems yourself, then you get it. And so basically, I think the same thing that was said here, I've said it here again, so I'm not going to repeat that. Here is an interesting problem. For a parade, marchers are arranged in column of 7, but one person is left out. If we arrange them in column of 8, 2 people are left out. If we arrange them in column of 9, 3 people are left out. So how many marchers are there? So this is actually application for the Chinese Riemannian theorem, because we know x, whatever x is, equal to 1 mod 7, it is also 2 mod 8, and it is also 3 mod 9. We don't know x. So, in the previous example, we had given you x and you did the mod. Here we don't know x, but we give you the modular values. So the question is, what is x? Okay? So it's the same formula as here, but you need to find out a. You are given a mod mi, you are given all of this, you can calculate. If you do all of this, you can get a. Right? So, let's see. So, n in this case is 7 times 8 times 9 is 504. And we are given 1 times 504 divided by 7. And then the inverse of that with mod 7. Then 2 times 500, 4 by 8, with inverse of that, mod 8. So this inverse is with respect to mod 8. And similarly, this one inverse mod 9. So now you have to calculate what is the inverse of 72 mod 7, what is the inverse of 63 mod 8, and what is the inverse of 56 mod 9. If you calculate that, somehow you will know that that is 4, 7 and 5. Those inverses are 4, 7 and 5. Once you know that, you can multiply them together. You will get a number like 2010 mod 504. You subtract it, you get 488. So there are 488 marchers. Now you can verify that that is correct. 488 mod 7, you should get a 1. I mean, basically you divide 488 by 7 and then see whether you get a 1. So that number, that answer is incorrect. But whatever is the correct answer, if you would have gotten the correct answer, then you would have gotten 1, 2 and 3. Double check. Alright, now I can later on check it out as to where it is wrong. Maybe that's something that you can do it yourself too. So this answer is 488 doesn't look like. Now let's just try 488 mod 8. 488 mod 8 is 0. So this answer is clearly wrong. Alright, so now let us see. Let's add up these numbers. 288 plus 8882 is 1,170. 170 and 840 is 170 is 9, 10, 10, 10. Yeah, 2010. So this part looks like correct to me. Now when we subtract 504, 504, yeah, so this looks like it must be 498. 504 times 4 is 2020. So 2020 minus 29. So it's 10 less than 404. 494. Let me try 498 or 494. You can write down 498 and then let's check it out with 498. 498 would give you 1 mod 7, that's for sure. 49 and 8, that's correct. 498, when you use 498, you get 2, yeah, 2 mod 8 is correct. And 498 divided by 9, 9, 45, gives me 48, 3, yeah. So 498 is the correct answer, and you can double check that. So primitive roots. So what is a primitive root? A primitive root is one which has no, which is coprime. Basically, if it is coprime, then it will satisfy this condition, a raised to phi n is equal to mod n equal to 1. And then if p is prime, and now here's the thing, sometimes in this whole chapter they are mixing up p and n. So if n is prime, then it will generate the group mod n. Alright? Because if n is prime, then phi n is equal to n minus 1. Right? And therefore you will generate the whole group. So here is the thing. N, let's say mod 19. Mod 19, if A is 1, all the powers of 1 are given here. If A is 2, all the powers of 2 are given here. If A is 3, all the powers of 3 are given here. Notice that everything raised to 18 is 1, right? But you don't have to go all the way there. For some things, you can do it much less. So for example, you get a, for 1, you get a power 1, but for 4, you get power of 9. For 5, 9, and this one, and for 7, you get 2, and so on and so forth. So these are the primitive roots. Primitive roots are the one that don't get a 1 before they reach the end. Because with 2, you have to go all the way to 18 to get a 1. And therefore it will generate the whole set. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, up to 19 in this set. And similarly with 3, similarly with 10, similarly with 13, 14 and 15. These are the primitive roots. The primitive roots are the one that require the complete p minus 1 to make them 1. Other values that don't require full, they are not primitive roots. So they can generate the whole set. They are also called the generator for this whole set. Either one of them will act. Any one of them will act as generator. 2, 3, 10, 13, 14, and 15. Obviously, this is a good exercise for Excel. You can write this in Excel and give any number and it will prepare the whole table, and then you can see which are the primitive roots. Okay, now that we talked about the primitive roots, the last thing that we need to talk about is the logs. So what is the definition of the log? And here we are talking about discrete log, not the real, not the other ones. So if B is equal to A raised to I mod P, then I is the log of B base A mod P. So it could be written either as a discrete log discrete log base A of B mod P, or sometimes we write log 3 comma, we also write the P right there in the along with that, so we know what the modulus is. So for example, if somebody asks you what is the log of 4 base 3 in mod 13 arithmetic, what is the log of 4? What power of 4 will be equal to 3? What power of 3 will give you 4? No power of 3 will give you 4, right? So the discrete log doesn't exist. But if somebody asks you what power of 2 will give you 3, that has the answer 4. Because 2 raised to 4 is 16, which is 3 when you do mod 13. So now you know how to take log in mod, right? We did how to multiply, how to divide, and so on and so forth. Now we know how to do log. But one thing to notice is that the log is even harder than exponentiation. Exponentiation is difficult. You have to multiply so many times. But log is very difficult. So this is what this is the basis of this whole public key. So for 19, if you take log base 2, then for each number, this is the answer. How did we get this answer? We can go back to the previous table, and if we are doing power of 2, then we know that the log of 4 is 1, log of 4 is 2, log of 8 is 3, and log of 16 is 4, log of 13 is 5, and so on and so forth. So you read the number here, and the power here gives you the log. Right? So you can write down this in another method here, where here is the number, and here is the log. So when you raise 2 raised to 18, you get a 1. 2 raised to 1, you get a 2. 2 raised to 13, you get a 3. And so on and so forth. We have mod 19. Similarly, then you can do base 3, base 10, base 15, base 14, and so on and so forth. But these are all primitive roots. If it was not a primitive root, then what will happen? Suppose you select 7. 7 is not a primitive root. Then you won't be able to get log of anything other than 1 and 11. If you want to get a log of 8, there is nothing there, because no power of 7 is equal to 8. No power of 7 is equal to 6. No power of 7 equal to 9. So the discrete log base 7 does not exist. Okay? But discrete log base 10 exists for all numbers. Discrete log base 9 doesn't exist for all numbers. Only these many numbers can be generated with 9. And similarly with 8 doesn't exist, and so on and so forth. So only primitive roots will give you all the numbers, and the logs will exist. And for our class, the best way to find primitive root is by exhaustive enumeration. So if I ask you a question whether 2 is a primitive root of 19, you just have to write down 2 raised to 1, 2 raised to 2, 2 raised to 3, 2 raised to 4, and so on and so forth. All right, that finishes this chapter. And let's just slowly go through each of the points we said. First of all, Fermat's little theorem said that A raised to, for any P where P is prime, P minus 1, A raised to P minus 1 is always 1. For any prime number. If it is not a prime, then we need to find the Euler's torsion function, and then A raised to Euler's torsion function is equal to 1. And what is the Euler's torsion function for a prime, P? For prime numbers, it is equal to P minus 1. For non-prime numbers, you just find out all the primes and multiply their minus 1, P minus 1, P minus 1, you know, whatever numbers those are, right? So that is you have to remember, right? Then primality testing. You do the testing, and that was the Miller-Raven's test, was that you first express it as 2 raised to k minus q, then you can take any random a, raise it to the power q, and see if it is 1 or n minus 1. If it is not, then you go to square and cube and so on and so forth. And actually, I missed here one more point. That should be a raised to q equal to n minus 1, or 2q equal to n minus 1, and so on and so forth. And then you know whether it is composite or inconclusive. Then the Chinese remainder theorem, we studied Chinese remainder theorem. All it does is that you divide the big M into little m's, and then you can calculate the complete mod by piece by piece, by inverting things. Then we talk about primitive roots, and the primitive root is the one that generates the whole set. If it generates the whole set, then the lowest value of m that will give you a raised to m equal to 1 is equal to p minus 1, and therefore you can take a log with respect to that. And if it is not a primitive, then many of the logs will not exist, and the log is defined as usual. Okay? So sometimes we write like this, either d log or just log b comma p, where b is the base and p is the modulus. So first you have to use the Fermat's theorem to find a number x between 0 and 22 such that x raised to 1, 1, 1 is congruent to 8 modulo 23. X raised to 11 is congruent to 8 modulo 23. So now, whenever you have two problems like this, first of all, you should notice that all of the numbers can be reduced below 23. So this 1, 1, 1, 1, 111, first thing is that you should reduce that to below 23. Right? Once you reduce that power to below 23, because everything raised to 22 would be equal to 1, so you just 110 can be taken out right there. Right? So do not use brute force searching. Right. Then so Miller's Raven test to test 19 for primality. Now here I would have said more likely, here in the home you can probably do all the numbers between 1 and 18 and whatnot, but or whatever makes sense. But here I would have said, you know, try two numbers, you know, two random numbers. Or I would have given you two numbers that you need to try. And then x equal to 2 mod 3 and 3 mod 5 and 5 mod 7, what is x? What theorem you have to use? Chinese remainder theorem to find that, right? So you will do 3 times 5 times 7, 3 times 5 is 105, and then you do, you know, just do the inverse and all that. Primitive roots of 11, this one is exhaustive search. Basically, you want to find out all the primitive roots of 11, just see, you know, where you, if you find a number that is, takes less than 10, then you cross that out, and if it goes all the way to 10, then that is a primitive root. Find the discrete log of 17 base 2 mod 29. Again, you have to just write down all the powers of 2. Actually, you don't have to write down all the powers of 2. You just have to write down the powers of 2 until you get 17.